sin. By every succeeding generation, grant that just as being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth. So by the sanctification of grace, we may bear the image of the man of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Because of Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world, have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. If I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, he would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die, so Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? You, your own nation, and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in it, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak, and they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to him,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who had me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench, in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Golgotha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carried the cross himself. He went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews."
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but pass lots for it to see who is it will be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled, it says, "They divided my garments among them, and from my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there, whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the Spirit. Now since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken, that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted him. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. In the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We now begin a series of petitions.
Please be seated. As a child, Holy Week was a special time for my family. Mom made sure that the spirit of Easter was celebrated first and foremost over the secular perspective of the holiday. It was a time to remind us of the unique sacrifice of a God who sent his only Son into the world to die for our sins. Our homes and families are often referred to as the first church that passes on the faith to our children. I was so blessed to have a mom and dad that took that responsibility to heart. We grew up knowing Christ in each other and in the Holy Eucharist. It was through the days of Lent and Holy Week that we became immersed into the greatest love story ever. A story of a loving Father who was hurting because of our sinfulness and disregard for his teachings. A Father who wanted to provide us a path to salvation if we desired. As we hear in John's Gospel in chapter 3, verse 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Last night on Holy Thursday, we celebrated in a Eucharistic meal that originated with Christ and his apostles on the night before he died. He gave us an eternal sacrifice that we represent in every Mass. This is the new and everlasting covenant between God and his people, a promise that he will be with us until the end of time, a gift of his body, the Church, in which his holy priesthood continues in apostolic succession even to this day, a Church that is called to serve others as followers of the one who sent them. Each of us is called to be servants to one another. The gift of the Holy Eucharist could only be given through the sacrifice of an unblemished lamb. Christ will be that sacrifice as he was nailed to the cross on Good Friday. A man free of all sin, taking on the sinfulness of the world since the time of Adam until the very last day. A burden and suffering that is not fully appreciated by so many. This is what my mom focused on Good Friday, from 12 noon till 3. She would take a shoebox that was in the closet filled with prayer cards, religious books, and rosaries, and the family Bible, along with a wooden cross, and place them on an empty kitchen table. My siblings and I would sit at the table with Mom for 3 hours of prayer. We were not allowed to drink, eat, or speak unless we were praying. It was a time to focus all of our being on the sacrifice made by our Lord and to enter into the emotions of the Paschal sacrifice. It is a treasured memory that I hold close in my heart. Good Friday should be a somber and emotional time all Christians, a moment to realize that each of us will face our own Good Fridays as we navigate through life. Since Ash Wednesday, we have seen our daily lives turned upside down due to this pandemic. This has been an event that has literally impacted every person in our world. We have seen sporting events, entertainment, and even industry grinding to a halt. Schools and universities have shut down, impacting students and teachers. Many wonderful events, such as prom and graduation, and even weddings, have been canceled. Our elderly are feeling alone and scared. Those hospitalized are seeing the fragile nature of their human condition. Those who are dying must now do so alone and afraid. Their families cannot be with them in their most vulnerable moment. We are experiencing a Good Friday like no other, and many are lost. Many are feeling depressed and anxious about the future and when life may return to some semblance of normal. During this time when each of us is carrying our own cross, it is important to remember that our journey to Calvary is a sharing of our Lord's suffering, his death, and his resurrection. We all must unite as the one body of Christ to heal our broken world. We must serve and love one another. We must willingly accept this burden in union with the crucified Christ for the salvation of our world. Do not lose hope. Do not be afraid. I trust in Jesus and know that he has broken the bonds of death and given each of us a share in his resurrection. Rejoice and be glad. May we never take his gift of the Holy Eucharist for granted. In times such as this, we begin to realize the great gift of the Holy Mass and the priesthood, and we yearn to share that experience as a community of believers. I leave you with a final thought to keep in mind when you watch the next Mass. During the Eucharistic prayer, the priest will place his hands over the bread and wine and consecrate them so that they become the body, blood, soul, and divinity of our Lord. At that very moment, each of us is called to a Passover meal. This act unites our altar here in our church with the altar in heaven, where all of our loved ones are at the same table, sharing the same Eucharistic celebration. I pray that we all take this time to reflect on our lives and how we can grow closer to our Lord through our own suffering. May God be with you.
We now begin a series of solemn intercessions in which we pray for the church, pray for the world, and many, many other causes this year. A special prayer has been added to these prayers, a prayer for all those experiencing the difficulties of the pandemic we're undergoing now.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Almighty and living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith and confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Always serve you faithfully through
that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty and ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself.
Touching the cross, simply pause for a moment and meditate on gratitude in all that Christ has done for us.
You may.
We now begin the final part of the liturgy for Good Friday, the reception of Holy Communion for the few who are here. The hosts were consecrated to the Mass of the Lord's Supper last evening. The service is not a Mass, but really a remembrance of the Lord's suffering and death, culminating in the reception of the Holy Communion.
Thank you.
time. Please participate in prayer for spirituality. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you were already there, I embrace you and unite myself wholly to you. Permit not that I should be ever separated from you.
Let us pray. Almighty and living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, and by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting renewal.